Good evening, good afternoon, and welcome to this amazing interview here today for the son of a bishop. This is a book signing that would take place, but we're going to kick it off with an interview. So I'm so excited. My name is Clarissa Kenty, and I'll be your moderator for this afternoon right here at the hosting church, Refresh Family Church, Refresh Nation, under the pastoral leadership of Apostle Stephen A. Davis and Lady Davis. We're so, so excited to be here. In order to kick this off, we certainly would need to have prayer to cover this amazing event. And I'm going to turn it over to Apostle Davis.
Well, thank you so much. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we bless you and we honor you today. We thank you for a son of a bishop who is here with us today, not just to promote a book, but to maintain a legacy of a great leader who came through this earth and shook the entire earth. So, Father, we pray over this session this evening, God, that you would come in tremendously through the power of the Holy Spirit, that you would rest in this place and rest on the streaming, that wisdom, knowledge, and understanding and empowerment will come from this session. So we give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. In the matchless name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Man, listen, I already started taking a look at this book, and I think I've probably laughed out loud, literally laughed out loud by myself reading this book. And what I like about this book, Apostle Davis, is that it's an easy read. Now, I don't like long, thick books that I cannot get into, but it's just kind of like, Ed, you just kind of like you're talking to me through this book. So it was really, really great. I'm loving it, and I know that you will love it too. We certainly want you to go out to edlongjr.com. That's edlongjr.com. Go ahead and grab this book and get it into your house. This book, and I'm going to let him talk a little bit more about it later, but this book, Apostle Davis, is for parents. It's for children. It's for children of parents who are pastors and ministers. And I mean, this book is for everybody. And it's very rare that you can find a book that covers a multiplicity of people and from different areas. So this book, Ed, I think I could call you a couple of things based on this book, but I'm going to stick with Ed. But Ed, you nailed it with this. It's truly a blessing. So certainly excited about that. You come with a long line of background. You 25 years plus of ministry. You're licensed. You're ordained. You're a relationship coach. You're a teen ministry. I mean, the list goes on and on for you. And you got, I think you have about two or three degrees.
Two. We're going to work on the third.
We're working on the third one now, right? Okay. So you're no dummy in the industry, okay? You really have a lot going on, a lot like your dad. My connection with your father was when my dad was living. And he visited the church and came home. And he was like, oh, my gosh, y'all, this guy is just amazing. So we had, like, back then it was cassettes. I don't think they sell cassettes anymore, but back then it was tape cassettes. So we had your dad's sermons and all this stuff in our house when we were younger. So that is my connection to your father. So even then, my dad introduced your dad to us as being someone who believed in building people, communities, businesses. And so that's kind of how I was introduced to your dad.
Sounds like an awesome introduction.
It's an amazing introduction. So I'm just so honored to for Apostle Davis to allow me this opportunity here today. So,
well, I knew that you would do a wonderful job, and Ed Long Jr. will be perfectly represented and very safe with you.
I hope so. We're going to see, because this book kind of takes me a lot of places, so we hope.
I told you, we can go there. Let's go.
But we don't want to get Apostle Davis in trouble, so we'll keep it safe.
I got you.
So, Ed, tell us a little bit more about you and why this book, because the book cover is so precious, but once I got into the meat, I said, oh, Lord, you know. So I always ask a multiplicity of questions. So we'll start with the first one. Why son of a bishop?
Great question. And I want to start by simply saying good afternoon. Good afternoon to everyone who is here in the house on this afternoon. I'm really honored that you would take time out of your Saturday to come hang out with Apostle Davis and this whole collective. specifically myself, to talk about a book that I wrote. I don't take that lightly. I don't take it for granted. I am truly grateful. I'm grateful to you as well for facilitating this. I don't know what it costs to cut these lights on. I don't know what the bills were. I don't know any of these type of things. I don't know what the axe was. I know that you're moving and shaking in this city, and I know that you may ask many things from leadership. And just another axe on a Saturday when people are looking to have some time to themselves, I don't take this for granted. So I say thank you, and thank you so very much. The question you asked is an awesome question. And I think it's even not so much as to why son of a bishop, but also why now? I don't know if there's any aspiring artists or authors or creatives who are in here this afternoon, but you know, anytime you set foot on something that's uncharted territory for you in particular, that can be a ride within itself. I've spoken sermons, I've written songs, I'm a Stellar Award-winning songwriter, and things of that nature, produce TV shows, Stellar Award-winning radio personality, etc. And so the arts for me are just the same thing in just a different expression. But writing a book, this book in particular, was an emotional roller coaster, all right? And I once heard someone say, I've been telling everybody, I once heard someone say this to me. He said, look, if something is bothering you, if it ain't gonna matter in 5 years, don't spend more than about 5 minutes on it. You feel me? Ladies, you know, I don't know if you're on the job, if you're working from home now, or you got this and that going on and something troubles you. If you got to go in the bathroom for 5 minutes and get your mascara together and all of that, do that. But it's really a challenge of looking at situations and really putting them on the scale. How heavy is this for real? Now, this is light work. I ain't going to spend more than a few minutes on this, and I ain't going to let this distract me or let this miraculous day turn into a bad day because of a little event. But there have been so many different micro and mega traumas that have taken place since my father's transition. For those who may not know, my father is Bishop Eddie Lee Long, and he transitioned January 15, 2017. So here we are 5 years later, and I felt like for his life and the experiences in his life and post his life, oh, it's going to matter after 5 years. It's going to matter for years to come. So this book literally took me 5 years to the T to write. And we released it January 13th. January 13th is the 28th anniversary of his bishopric consecration. So he transitions January 15th. In 2017, that was actually Martin Luther King Jr.'s birthday. Now, we celebrated on the Monday after, if you will, but it was literally the 15th. So as the things, the numbers align, we got the 13th, which is the bishopric anniversary, the 15th, which marks 5 years of his transition, and then it was in 2017 that he transitioned, but the 17th was MLK Day this year. So everything, the numbers were just working together. I found favor with Dr. Cynthia Hale to be able to go back to the original New Birth, the first building that Pop and the membership of New Birth co-labored together to build. And we held the book signing there. So it was nostalgia, if you will, to go back into that place where the oil was originally working. You feel me? And just be in that presence. And, you know, it's been so much bad news, pandemic this, church this, all these things. And my thing is, it's time for a shift, your conference. It's time for the tide to change. And sometimes we got to grab the bull by the horn. I'm sick of being a church person that's waiting for God to do something. I'm excited about folks like David who said, Lord, do I have the favor? Yes, you do. Pursue. Recover. Take it all. So it's not just the faith, but it's the faith coupled with the works. And it's like, Lord, we've been praying. Well, son, it's time to get to work. You feel me? And so we don't have son of a bishop as the title if it wasn't for the bishop reconsecration. So I had to go back there for that lunch. So that's the why.
You know, as you were talking, you mentioned the number five. Mm. So I looked that up to see what the number five meant on biblical terms, Apostle. And it means grace, goodness, and favor.
R-A-C-E. Come on.
Favor. And you mentioned favor twice in the last 2 seconds of you talking.
Come on.
Favor. And so I don't believe that God does things just by happenstance. I think everything is systematic and it's intentional. And so when you talk about the favor here, and I believe what this book is going to do, it's going to release grace on people. As I'm reading this book, I'm looking at grace. Mm. I'm looking at the fact that it didn't dawn on me, Apostle, that my children are PK kids.
You better know it.
And I'm thinking, because I'm a minister for over 20-some-odd years. My husband's a minister. And I said, my kids, they're PK kids. What does that mean? So when I look at that and I'm like, this book is going to bless them. Because you have questions at the end of each chapter, yep, that's making them think. Mm-hmm. You know, as a kid, okay, what about this? What about that? And then as a parent, are you okay with this? Did you know this was taking place? It's pushing us to think beyond our current situation. That's why what I see in this particular book. Apostle, what do you think about this?
Well, one thing that brought me to a pause is when you said January the 13th, mm-hmm, was your dad, my bishop and apostle's consecration day. As I was at his house on January the 13th,
wow,
of 2017.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
And it almost knocked me off of my seat, wow, when you said that. So there's so much that we don't know that you can share with us through your book. Mm-hmm. There's so many details about a great man. Only a PK could tell you the true story. Most people are looking for so many avenues to gain information. Mm-hmm. But when you look at the son of a bishop, he is the only one that can really give you the details that matters the most, that's going to transform people's lives. That's what I'm getting out of this.
Yeah.
And it's powerful.
Praise God. Praise God.
It is powerful. Now, let me ask you, because some of these titles of these chapters, things like secure the bag.
Come on.
Sex ed. Boom. That's all we see on this is boom. And so I looked at stuff like Young Dirty Bishop.
Come on.
And I'm thinking, what? But it's making me want to read the books. How did you come up with these names?
I didn't really come up with them. It's just my life. You know, when you just own who you are, you know, you don't have to try to be something. You
right,
know, you
right.
just exist, if you will. So, yes, those are some very salacious titles to chapters.
Yes.
Let me give this caveat for our collective in this room today, as well as those who are streaming. The purpose of the book is to help parents to be able to parent more transparently. Mm. All right? So what happens is, if you want to be a good parent, you can be a good parent, a great parent, an awesome parent, all of these things. These are compound words. They're phrases, if you will. But transparency is not a compound word. It's just a word. The root of it is parent, if we want to go that way, or trans, if we want to go that way. What's my point? My point is that oftentimes parents, I've got 15-some-odd years of youth pastoring, are uncomfortable or afraid of expressing their true self to their children. But parent, transparent, is a greater level of parenting without being compounded. It's just stretching the word. And so it's a challenge to parents to be able to parent more transparently while sharing transparent stories of my father and I. There's lessons that he taught me that I didn't get the aha moment till years later. What your grandma used to say? Just keep living, baby. You know, some of the deacons in the church I was a part of up in Carolina, my mama's side, they would say, well, say what you want, but you're going to have to come this way one day. You feel me?
Yeah.
So what happens is I'm sharing these transparent stories because so many people view my father as a father.
Right.
So many people viewed him as a mentor. So many people viewed him in whatever perspective that they viewed him in. It empowers him to still lead from transition. You feel me?
That's good.
Because I have these stories. I believe the word that we read is just a collection of stories that all of humanity gets to benefit from. So why should I keep these stories in a vault when they can be a blessing to parents to parent more transparently? They can be a blessing to households and homes and to other families and legacies and all these things, because it's a different lens. In viewing them as a father, there's only four of us that actually grew up in the house. And so now a parent can look and say, Bishop didn't get that right, but then he recovered. Whew. I can take the pressure off myself. I don't have to be perfect. I just have to continue to be perfected in Christ. And then for offsprings, the challenge, the healthy challenge, is how do I develop my voice while I'm connected to something? It's not even just being a pastor's kid or the offspring of someone who's in church leadership. But, you know, entrepreneurship, we got a cleaners, a car wash, some sort of enterprise, and I'm in it, but I don't want to be in it. How do I respect what my parents have established while charting my own course for a lifetime or for just a season? And so as you touched on before, I didn't have a blueprint on how to write a book. I just had the desire, the unction, the passion, and just did the work with the support of others, that this work, I pray to God, can help families be more transparent and continue to be perfected.
That's amazing. You know, I think a lot of people are probably or have been waiting for something like this since Bishop Long's passing, kind of the behind the scenes type thing. This is probably a long time coming. I think it's great that we're able to see it from your point of view, you know. And I was just thinking, if your dad could write a foreword for this book,
wow,
what do you think he would say?
I can't say it.
I did read in here Bishop was a little cusser every now and then. Hey,
maybe he left me here to write it for you. I could probably say it a little different, but so it'll be fit.
Listen, so it's a chapter in there. It's called Parental Advisory.
Right.
When y'all read Parental Advisory, I want you to slide in my DM and let me know your thoughts. That's going to be the answer to that question right there.
But what I noticed, just my time with your dad, that he was transparent. He was himself.
Exactly.
So how can you raise kids that are not like you, walk in your own right, stand in your own right, believe in what you're called to do, and step into it? Because that's what he done. Mm-hmm. You know, there's not many preachers that wore muscle shirts in the pulpit. So how can we restrict you? And he was unleashed.
Right.
Apostle, there are very few that could wear muscle shirts. Yeah.
That's a double conundrum right there.
You have that. That's correct.
I saw on your Instagram the other day. I saw you pushing some metal. You said, all right, 2023 is on the way. David's going to have it.
Hey, watch this. Watch.
I see what you're up to.
But I like that. I like what you said, Apostle. And I believe that's definitely spot on. I think you would be very proud of this, because this book is very transparent. I think I read a part where, on the parenting side, where you were with your Uncle Joe.
Yeah.
And you ordered. ordered some food.
Oh, come on.
Very high end.
Spoiler alert, here we go.
Lobster and all kind of great things. I think you were 11 or 12, yeah. You know. And I like the response that he gave you. And, I, you know, and I'm going to be honest. I probably would have said it exactly the way he said it, with all of the words. But let's talk a little bit about that, because I think that based on what I read, you, it seemed to have been a great moment for you as an 11-year-old, as a 12-year-old, and then your dad kind of wonk, wonk, wonk.
Initially. Frustrated.
Yeah, let's talk about that.
Yeah, it's, you know, Pop had a unique way of taking the steam out of a good time, if you will. He always wanted us to walk in humility, all right? And, you know, he did a great job in celebrating us. But the overarching lesson was to never take advantage of people. And here I was, 11, 12 years old, and we're, you know, hanging out, and an opportunity is extended to me. And it was innocent. I took advantage of a situation, but I didn't view it like that because it wasn't presented to me like that. You feel me? But within that, he checked me immediately. As we were going up on that elevator, my esteem was coming down real quick. And, you know, as it didn't fully make sense to me then, as I got into my young adult years, 20s and all, I was faced with another situation. I want to share this one more so to fully reserve that for the book, but I was rapping. Still do. Got a new single out. We got another song as well. But there was an artist who was having prolific success. This song is a hit. It still plays in the club right now. And we're talking about 17, 18 years ago. And the record label owner and a very dear friend of mine had worked together. And so I was trying to get on with the label as well. Spoke with the record label owner. He gave me an opportunity to go into the studio. Now, at this time, I'm still fresh in music, if you will. He owes me nothing. Calls me up, sets up the studio time. I go, I blaze the track. I in my guesstimation, I killed it. He calls me afterwards, man, I heard it was fire, man, all of this. I'm like, okay, great. Yeah, I appreciate it, man. You know, I'm feeling real good. Now, he hits me with a trick question. I didn't know it at the time. He said, hey, man, so what do I owe you? I said, oh, okay, well, we're doing business now. So I said, man, you can just throw me a stat. Now, for layman's terms, you know, because I know we come and slam on this altar here, you know, come around 9 a.m. tomorrow, all right? Let me give you a few terms. A stack is $1,000. You feel me? It's a stack of 100, it's a stack of 20, however you stack it up. But a stack is $1,000. Now, I'm 19. I don't have any commercially released music. I don't have any awards yet. And I tell this man, well, just throw me a stack. He says to me, okay, cool, I got you. Told me where to pick up the check. I grabbed it. It didn't bounce. I continue to reach out to him. I'm thinking we're in good terms. To this day, I have not heard back from him. Wow. To this day. So I'm talking to my friend who introduced me to him, and I said, man, yeah, you know, I ain't heard from such and such, man. I've been hitting him up or whatever. He was like, oh, really? That's not like him. He said, I just talked to him the other day. You know, we working on some stuff. And I said, yeah, man. I said, you know, he blessed me with the check and all of that. And so my friend looked at me and said, what? I said, yeah, he gave me $1,000. He said, you asked him for $1,000? I said, well, he asked me, what did I want? He said, no, bro, no, you messed it up. I said, okay, holler at me. What's going on? He said, well, you know, I've written two or three songs for him. He asked me the same question the first time I wrote for him. And I told him, man, you don't owe me anything. God bless you, man. I'm just honored that you would use me. So the lesson I learned was, what my dad was teaching me at 11. It came up in my professional career. Don't take advantage of anyone. Be clear about where you are in life. This guy has the hottest song, not just in the country, but in the world at this time. What benefit am I to him right now? And I'm seeking him out for something to benefit me. So Pop's teachings, they reverberate in so many different ways. And these are the type of things that aspiring artists, youth, I want to understand. And for parents to be empowered with these kind of stories to help their children and offspring navigate through life.
So Ed, for those young people who are watching, who are streaming now, what would you tell them? You know, because sometimes they don't really want to hear from mom and dad, or probably think we're not quite as knowledgeable as they would think we need to be. Mm-hmm. What would you tell them based on this experience? Because we certainly don't want our children to repeat our mistakes. And if we can kind of guide them other places, that's what we want to do. Mm-hmm. So what would you tell them?
Great question. The first thing I would tell them, I'm trying to find which camera we're looking at because this is really important. I think we're right here
straight
in the back.
Ahead,
I see, yes. The first thing I would tell them is to confirm, yeah, your mama is crazy. And so is your daddy. I just want you to
hit. Can we censor that, please? Cut that part out.
That's the first thing.
He's got their attention now, though.
I want you to understand is that you're right. Your mama is crazy. I'm just going to let that sit for a minute, all right? They laughing because they know it. Now, as right as you are about your parents being crazy, the unfortunate part is you really don't know how crazy they are, all right? So I don't want you to experience that. Understand this. No good parent hopes the worst for their child. I'm being very specific. Not a good parent. No good parent wants the worst for you. A good parent wants the best for you. A good parent wants you to take that baton and run way further than they could ever imagine. It may not look like that now, the discipline, the being on you, the choice words, the no's when you wish it was a yes, and the direction to tell you to do certain things that you just ain't feeling. It may not look like it right now, but instilling of character for your success is what's taking place right now. So the sooner we can accept that our folks are crazy in love with us and crazy about us having Jesus in our life, crazy about us knowing God for ourselves, crazy about all of these kind of things, accept it. I'm a grown man, married, second marriage, been married before, a father to be, baby in the oven right now, all of these things, but my mama is still crazy about me now. It ain't gonna change.
That's right.
So just accept it, understand it, and learn how to utilize it for your benefit. Mom, since you're so crazy about me, won't you take me to view this school? Mom, since you're so crazy about me, I got this dream. Can you help me to execute this? Daddy, since you are so crazy in love with me, can we discuss how we can finance something? Utilize that love to get you to where you see yourself going.
That. So Sasha
sees me as being crazy.
The cat's out the bag.
Okay. I'm glad you clarified that for me because I wasn't sure, but now I understand what's going on.
Glad to help.
Yeah, thank you so much. I believe you're going to help a whole lot of people.
And how does that make you feel, Apostle?
Say that
again.
How
does that make you feel?
Crazy. But the thing of it is, you know, as you were talking and your dad was teaching you not to take advantage of a moment, and I never, as a spiritual son, I never felt that I was being taken advantage of by your dad.
That's awesome.
And that DNA is in you. Just be truthful with me. And he was always truthful. And I never, in all the days I served under him, I never felt like I was taken advantage of.
Wow. Wow,
and that was so powerful, what you said. That tells me that he loved me. Because he was crazy in love with me. Because he didn't know this old Birmingham country boy from anything. But he allowed me to come in.
True.
And I was always honored. So I always gave honor.
That's right.
And that's what's valuable about hearing from the son of a bishop.
Praise God. He loved you, for sure.
Yeah. You know, Apostle, I was going to actually ask you a question close to that. You are now a father to so many people. A spiritual father to so many people. Do you take the same mythology that Ed mentioned, and are you incorporating that into so many people that you, I mean, you're not just leading and a father to Refresh Family Church, you are a father to Refresh Nation. So how are you implementing the things that he shared today?
Well, one thing I just took away is that I'm crazy about all these people. Yeah. Just like I'm crazy about Lady Davis and Sasha, Amber and April, grandkids, I'm crazy about these people. But I learned it from his dad. His wife was on a panel some years ago, and the moderator asked her, what is his weakness? And she responded, the people. The people were his weakness. He loved them so much. And I can say this, because I got close enough to hear him and to sense certain things, how much he loved his kids. Yeah, he talked about you all the time. So my reaching out to you previously was because I knew his love for you. And every genuine person should know the love that a senior leader has, not just for everyone he's crazy about, but also for his family. So we're on this stage together, which is a monumental moment for me, and I know for you, but it speaks volume to who he was, because we're sons and daughters of a bishop. I turn it back to you before I start crying.
Yeah, but I want to see that, though.
I felt it.
Can we zoom in to Apostle, please, right here? Can we zoom in? Okay, there it is, right there. You know, Ed, like I said before, this book, guys, as you can tell as we're going through the interview, learning more about Ed, learning more about Apostle Davis's relationship with both of them, you can see where this book is a must-have. Go out there to edlongjr.com. EdLongJr.com. Go ahead and grab this book. It's a book you will not put it down. And like I said, you will truly laugh out loud when you're reading this book. It's an amazing book. And guys, remember, Ed Long will be ministering on tomorrow morning, 9 o'clock a.m. right here at Refresh Family Church. So we're excited about that. Looking forward to an amazing word. So will this be your first time ministering here?
No, we done jumped around up here.
You jumped around, so we're going to jump around tomorrow, too?
We lean with it, rock with it, all turn up.
I'll wear tennis shoes tomorrow, man.
All right, there you go. Good idea.
Yes. So, guys, be sure to go out there to his website, get the book, and make sure you come tomorrow at 9 o'clock a.m. right here at Refresh Family Church. Also, there's a book signing that will take place after this interview today. Certainly we hope that you're on your way. If you're not here right now, grab your book, a personal signing from Ed Long to just thank you for getting this book. It's really going to be a blessing to all of us when you come and do that. So let's go ahead and support him in that effort. Question for you. When did you learn that your parent or bishop was not perfect? I remember my moment. So did that moment ever come, or did you always know, or did you just have an aha moment?
I don't think I had an aha moment. You know, I start the book off, and the first chapter is called Homecoming. Not Beyonce's Homecoming, ladies. That's a total different situation, all right? But, you know, I don't remember my parents being together. You know, I'm from my dad's first marriage. So, you know, my parents got married, I think, in 81. I was born in 82. By 83, they had gone separate ways. So my normal is, you know, two different houses. That's my normal, okay? You know, I've always been back and forth. And I think just growing up, you know, if something didn't work out, then there was a reason. And that's not to put fault, if you will. But I think I just grew up accepting that, you know, my mama is my mama, my daddy is my daddy. And seeing them through the lens of life has happened, I'm here, so where are we going and what's going on? That makes sense to you? And so, you know, doing life in that manner, it allowed me to just really embrace both of my parents, good, bad, or indifferent, and be okay with it. You know, for my younger siblings, for others, you know, whose parents have been together their whole life, if there's ever any tremors of separation, it literally rattles the children's world. I've seen it time and time again. And that's something, you know, I was never able to relate to because, again, my normal was separation from the get-go. And I just learned how to abide within it. But God is sovereign, and his wisdom is infinite. You know, that's allowed me to stand with Pop through anything because I'm never one that's looking for perfection. I'm always looking for resolve. You feel me? I think some people struggle when things aren't perfect because it's a different type of test of faith. But some of us learn how to just abide in disruption or chaos and truly be okay. It's almost like when Yeshua, Jesus, is on the boat and hears this storm. This guy's getting probably the best sleep of his life. The one or two cruises I've been on once I got past that little seasickness.
Right.
Oh, man. You talk about some good sleep. You feel me? She know what I'm talking about. Norwegian, Carnival, all of that. Yeah. You. I ain't ready to dock yet. But everyone else, the discomfort, it ruptured their faith. So, you know, that's a uniqueness that some of us possess, that you have the ability to be comfortable in uncomfortable situations.
Well, speaking of an uncomfortable situation, one of my kids, I'm just being a little transparent, one of my kids shared on behalf of the others. And I have two adult children and I have a senior in high school.
Gotcha.
And they mentioned that they felt somewhat of the pressure of not wanting to disappoint us, me, as parents, my husband and I. And I don't know quite where that came from. I don't know what I did as a parent to make them feel like. And they felt like if they missed it, then it was at all-time low, you know. So what would make one feel that way?
It's a testament of the parent. You know, you can try to instill a level of fear, but that doesn't mean necessarily the person respects you or even cares.
That's good.
You know, sometimes we can be in a place where fear is instilled with us, so we'll do the right thing, not because of the master or the leader. We'll do it out of self-preservation.
Yeah, right.
You know, and if that's not understood or interpreted right, one could have a false sense of security around a relationship, thinking that these people respect me or honor me or whatever. No, they just scared.
I'm sorry, children. Forgive mama.
So I think in your situation, though, when a person says, I don't want to disappoint you, that's a sign of the connection y'all have. Because, you know, sometimes you will give up on yourself. Think about it, parents, from a role reversal. There's some days you might not want to lift a finger. And you good with it. I sit in here with these lights off. I can save a little money right now. Because of my kids, I can't stop. I got to get up and figure it out because of them. And so when we have good parents, we consider our parents and say, you know what? I could be wilding out, doing whatever. Or I could school for what? But no, I've watched my mama do too much. I watched my daddy sacrifice too much. I didn't get it then, but I get it now at 18, at 16, at 22. I got to win for them. I want to make them proud. And what better way can I say thank you? You know, before I really handed myself over to ministry, I was cool being the young, dirty bishop. Listen, that was great. But then when the arrest of the light bulb went off of, bro, you can literally destroy everything that your father has been faithfully building just because you cool with just doing you. My shift wasn't for me. I was enjoying it. But my shift was, how dare I? This man, I love this man. I appreciate this man. I don't exist without this man. I don't have the access without this man. I don't have the, whoa. I don't want to jack this up because of you. And even now in life, I could have plenty of excuses to say I'm done with church. To hello with all of that.
I need to use that
you
term.
Feel me? Yeah, I had to figure a way to get it off.
No, I'm learning something because I just say it.
Shout out to Bishop Monty Campbell. He taught me that one. But even now it's about legacy. And I love my dad too much that even in his physical absence, I don't want to disappoint him. That's not fear. Because he ain't here to whoop me. That's love, it's honor, it's respect, it's care. It's seeds that are beginning to show fruit.
I like that. I was feeling quite sad, but the way you put that, I feel a little better about myself.
There you go. Come on.
A little better. Because I believe that probably most of us as parents, you know, kind of wonder, well, did I hit it spot on or did I miss it? You know, did I? You know, it's always that little, you know, I have two adult kids and I still have one at home. And I believe that I'm definitely going to get these books for them because I think these books can probably help. Like I said, it wasn't but a couple of years ago when I realized my kids are PK kids. It just really did not, you know, when you do what you do, you don't think about that and the other things that come with it. And so even in your book, you talked about the privileges of being a son of a bishop, but also there's another side, the pressures of it too.
Definitely.
So it's the two P's.
Yeah.
So, you know, let's talk about your privileges. I mean, some people may assume privileges. Well, let's talk about your privileges, and then let's talk about some of the pressures that come with that.
Awesome. Great question. And you know, privileges is a overarching term. You know, I like how Bishop Paul Morton, he gave some words to the book, and, you know, that was important to me because, of course, he consecrated Pop. And, you know, he's a giant out here in the faith. And for me, this path, even me being here today, as you touched on a few moments ago, reconciliation, I think, is the cause of Christ. Humanity through sin, through Eve talking to herself manifested as the serpent, Adam, in-house issues with Eve and listening and getting out of position, etc. This led to dissension between humanity and God. And so here comes Jesus now into time for reconciliation of humanity with the Father. And so there's no better display of the kingdom than for there to be reconciliation amongst brethren. Reconciliation amongst family, all of these kinds of things, you feel me? And so by having Bishop Morton, a part of this writing, it spoke to reconciliation in a major, major way. It's demonstration. And so, you know, he was son of a bishop. I'm son of a bishop. We got son of a bishop. We, you know, we got daughters of a bishop, son of a bishop, all in this room, etc. And we have the privilege of being joint heirs with Christ. I want that to sit for a second. Some of us just don't realize it. It was easy for me to realize it because in the natural, you can just see, you know, my pops is mentoring celebrities. We eating at nice restaurants and, you know, people observe. This is before social media's boom. And so people give access based off the access that they've seen granted, emulating, and people give access because they want relationship, et cetera, et cetera. And I talked about some of the abuse of access that I had done, you know, and then, you know, the pressures that come along with it are the expectation of people. And we shy away from this expectation because we may feel inadequate. We may just not want to do something. You know, we may not understand it, and we feel a little inferior. You know, it's a myriad of reasons. It's no one reason based on situations as to why we may cower from some things or just avoid. But being an heir of my father, both were presented to me still to this day. And so you mature to it to learn how to properly utilize, not use. It's a difference, but utilize the access that you have and then how to embrace and grow through into the level that God is pushing one to for the other things that we may resent or not want to walk in. And so even on this afternoon right now, again, I'm speaking to joint heirs because all of us, many of us, some of us in this room were under the sound of my father's voice. Now, that gives you access to things in the natural as well as in the spirit, because the prayers were not conditional prayers. The prayers weren't even just individualistic prayers. That's why we can run the cassettes back, as you mentioned, or the DVDs or the streams. And the word still hits you here. It still reverberates because it's given access. And so some things, as we go back and listen to stuff, we may not have understood it then because we would have taken advantage of it. But now we've been through some other things. We may not have taken advantage of it then because we just didn't understand. We may not have taken advantage of it then because we thought it would always be, but now we know what it feels like to be in lack of that persona or certain things, a certain dynamic or orchestration. But now is the time. That's why I had to start moving, and I'm tapping into the things that have always been available to me, but I would have used them for self-glory. Now it's time to tap into things for his glory. Now it's time to tap in and demonstrate stuff. There would have been a time where you and I would have been talking. It would have just been about, man, I got this song I'm trying to work and all of this kind of stuff. You know, no, now it's time that we demonstrate reconciliation. Now it's time that we demonstrate the kingdom of God. Now it's time that we demonstrate what healing looks like so that households can be blessed and things can, and the open heavens. Now stuff can start dropping. Downloads can come because we're joint heirs. Jesus didn't come just for a moment. Jesus came for a movement. And now it's time to start moving. Because in them 5 minutes, we didn't know if it was going to matter 5 years from now or not. But now we understand that, yes, it did matter that Bishop Long was born. Yes, it did matter that a Stephen A. Davis is born, a Michelle Davis, and that you and it matters because legacy is on the line. So heirs, now we need to start utilizing the prayers, the promises, the prophecy, the words that were spoken. Are you ready? I'm saying right now. I know it's supposed to be a book conversation and an interview, but the Lord can choose to speak whenever he wants to speak. Now is the time for the saints of the Most High. I see some sons and some daughters of a bishop.
They are in here.
I see a remnant of people who have not forgotten that we didn't come to choose sides. I know churches are divided right now. It seems like the body of Christ is divided right now. How in the hell are we divided when we're supposed to be corralling around? Now, 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 now. This your house. It's fresh too. It's fresh.
What your dad understood is that the kingdom of God is from generation to generation. Mm. It's an everlasting kingdom. Mm-hmm. So if you don't raise up sons, there's going to be generations that are vacant.
That's it.
So if it goes from generation to generation, only the sons of the bishop can rule in each generation.
Oh, come on now.
I came to tell you today, the sons of the bishops
come on.
Are ruling in this generation. Right now. Right now. Right now.
Come on, somebody. Right now. Say now.
Now.
Say now.
Now.
Say now.
Now.
Right now.
Right now.
Don't miss it. Don't miss this. Wherever you are, wherever you came from, don't miss this. Cause it's for right now.
It's right now.
Ed Long Jr.
Praise God.
Son of a bishop.
Praise God.
If you're in this sanctuary right now, if you're on live stream, wherever you are, I'm sure if you're home, you're running around your kitchen, you're running around your living room, you're picking them up and putting them down. I mean, it's hot in this atmosphere. If you're stuck in a place, this is the book for you. If you're in leadership and you're having some issues and some questions, this is the book for you. If you are a child of a minister or a pastor, this is the book for you. If you are ministers, pastors, apostles, bishops, this is the book for you. It's life-changing. The energy that you're feeling right now is the same energy you will feel when you read this book, guaranteed. So listen, go out there to edlongjr.com. Go ahead and order the book. I would dare say get this book in bulk. Read it to your children in teen church, children's church. This is a powerful, powerful, powerful book. I'm telling you, it's amazing. This has been just an honor to be here today. This has been life-changing for me. It's been a blessing for me. I know it's been a blessing for you. Apostle Davis, I want to thank you so much for the honor and the privilege to be in this space right now. This has been amazing.
Well, we have enjoyed you, and you handled my guests extremely well. So we give you kudos for
Amen.
That.
Amen. Amen.
Because what they don't know, I'll fight for the son of a bishop.
That's a fact. I want to do one thing. I see we got maybe 3 or some odd minutes real quick. Is it possible we can take some questions? I don't know if there may be any questions. I mean, this is just off the cuff. I know we got protocols and things of that nature. And if it's not okay, I understand. Okay.
Yes. And while we're doing that, guys, remember that you can go to edlongjr.com, grab that book, and learn more about the ministry. He is not only a minister, but he's also a motivational speaker. He's a relationship coach. You can reach out, connect with him, bring him to your church, bring him to your organization so that he can pour into the lives of your people and also pour into the lives of the community. And remember, tomorrow morning, 9 o'clock a.m., he will be right here at Refresh Family Church, Refresh Nation, bringing the word of God. And you don't want to miss that. Come on out. Mask up. Mask up. And we got you at the door with that hand sanitizer and grab that temperature. Come on in. We are social distancing in here, so it will be great. It's safe, and you don't want to miss this moment. It's really going to be an amazing time. So at this time, we're going to take some questions from the audience. A couple, I'm sure we have some, by a show of hand. If you could raise your hand and let us know the question that you may have. Or you can stand, and we can bring that mic to you.
And it's no pressure, but I just wanted to put that caveat out there. If there's anyone, any question that you may have.
Pastor Gary Smith.
I thought that was him. I thought that was him.
Okay, I gotta look at the camera. So asking you, Edward Long, looking this way. Do you ever feel the pressure to be your father?
Great question. Come on. That's what I'm talking about.
Yes.
I have felt it. I don't feel it, but I have felt it. And outstanding question. You know, I think it's a natural thing. I think it's a natural thing anytime you're someone's namesake, you're someone's offspring or what have you. I think it's natural from a external pressure standpoint where people will try to speak something, you know. I also think it's natural from an adoration standpoint. You know, my dad is my hero. Not even was. He is. He's my hero. I mean, you know, I was a Hulk Hogan fan, a Deion Sanders fan when it came to football, of course, Michael Jordan, et cetera. And, you know, many of them I've met. My mother was a flight attendant throughout my entire childhood. So she would call me and have, oh, it's the Macho Man, Randy Savage, or Coco Beware, or, you know, various celebrities that would just speak to me on the phone. Great. I was ecstatic about that. But I have never celebrated anyone more than my father. And so I make that point because, you know, when you throw posters on the wall as a teenager or what have you, you know, you're throwing up people who you want to emulate. So it's not a bad thing, you feel me? But I grew past that, and Pop helped to affirm me in growing past that, in that, hey, you're my son. Nothing I can do about that, nothing you can do about that. But you are still Jeremiah 1:5, unique to the Lord. You feel me? There are some things about you that would be different expressions than I have. If you think about even Jeremiah came from a lineage of priests, all right? But the Lord predestined him to be a prophet. He was still a P, but just a different P. And so in that, at this time, understand, priests study to echo what was written. So priests were almost historians. Feel me? But prophets were futurist. Prophets spoke to what would come to pass, often to the point of death, to where it wouldn't even come to pass until after they had transitioned. So what am I saying? As a prophet, Jeremiah couldn't turn to his priestly bloodline for coaching concerning how to be a prophet. He had to rely and develop into who it was that he was called to be. And so my father was able to help me to transition beyond any attempt to be him, but be comfortable in being me. me as an extension of him, uniquely me.
That's a great answer. Yes.
Great question, bro.
How you doing?
Man, I'm great. How about you?
I'm doing good. I'm doing real good. You know, me, I'm not, you know, I don't have any celebrity or anything like that, you know, attached to me. But, you know, I have my own challenges, you know. And with you being a son of a bishop, let me, I have to slow down when I say that because, you know, son of a bishop. It's that wordplay, you know. I have to slow down, but. But you, being a son of a bishop, what are some of the things that you do to make sure that you take care of yourself besides prayer? Some of the things that you do to make sure you take care of yourself mentally?
Great question. For those who couldn't hear me ask, you know, what do I do to take care of myself and all, and specifically mentally? Man, it's simple. Have fun. Have fun. Have fun. I don't know what your occupation is. I don't know what your role in the ministry is, etc. But life, work, all these things, boy, it will drain you. And church folk can bring you down quick. So you got to have some fun. You know, a lot of people have been talking about various things concerning the pandemic, health, this, all of these type of things, etc. In Proverbs, Solomon said, laughter is good for the spirit and the soul. He says this. He goes, my dad would say another further. He goes another further and says, it's like healing to the bone. Now, I want you to understand why that's so deep. My father's brother, I talk about him in the book, my uncle, Uncle Joe. Uncle Joe had prostate cancer, 16-year bout with it. It didn't kill him. It didn't beat him. What led to his transition was that his bones stopped producing bone marrow. Feel me. The core of us, your bone marrow is your innermost. You cannot live once you stop producing bone marrow. You think about Ezekiel 37, they're speaking to these dry bones. And everything else comes together once the dry bones are revitalized. Some people are suffering to their core because they forgot how to laugh. And I just believe that healing of our total self, laughter, can change so much for us. If you're dealing with cancer, if you're dealing with esteem, if you're dealing with depression, find a way to laugh. Have some fun, because the word of the Lord is true, that it brings healing to the soul, the spirit, like medicine to the bone. Bro, I laugh. I'm gonna laugh now. We're gonna do that.
Have one more question.
Right here. Okay. Good evening. Question.
Yes, ma'am.
What would you say to parents who know what God has spoken to them about their children, yet what they're seeing and witnessing in the behaviors of their children is the complete opposite? What would you say to them based on your own personal journey with you having that light bulb and then from your experience as a youth pastor?
Great question. What's your name? Jessica? Awesome. Good to meet you, Jess. Jessica asks, what would I say to a parent who knows what God has said to them about their child, although their child, my words, may be wilding out or going in a totally different direction or whatever the case may be? Well, I'm just going to give you back what you said. Recognize, number one, God said it to you, not the child. All right? So it's not their burden to bear. God can speak to whomever he wants to, no matter their age. God spoke to Samuel as a boy, and it shut up speaking to Eli. There was time where God was speaking to Eli about his sons. You feel me? So recognize God said it to you, not your child. So they're accountable to whatever God has or has not yet said to them. So when God's speaking to you about your child, that means that that's not their faith journey. it means it's your faith journey. You feel me? That you have to be faithful to what he said to you concerning them. And if he made that covenant promise with you, then he is faithful to keep it concerning you. So it's not something to go upside their head about, especially if they don't have that revelation. And that's why we go back to now what Solomon said. Train up a child in the way that they should go. And then it says, there's some tarrying there, because it comes back and says, when they are mature, then they'll come back around to it. So there's a whole tarrying space that there, and I feel you, that there may not be much that you can do about other than just be faithful to his word to you in the tarrying. Yes, ma'am.
That's good. That's good. I think we have one more, and this will be our last question.
Good afternoon.
Hey, how you doing?
Hey, I'm good. How are you?
I'm awesome. Awesome.
My question is for you, since you have a bun in the oven, and you're going to, you talked about being a transparent. So my question for you is, I remember Clarissa asking you about the moment you realized your father wasn't perfect, was it an aha moment and all of that. So as a parent, a future parent, you talked about being transparency. How do you intend on being transparent? At what age do you start letting your child know, hey, this is who I am, and just letting him know authentically who you are as his father? And the second part is, how do you intend on letting your father's legacy live on to your child? What are the things you plan on doing so he knows who your father was and to carry on that legacy?
Hey, I hope you're prophetic over there. She heard it kept saying he. Because I don't know what we carry. We are like 21 weeks, something like that. And so I don't want to know the gender till, you know, they pop out. You know what I'm saying? But I would love to have a son initially. And most importantly, a healthy child. But I heard them he's, so I appreciate you. Dynamic question. And, you know, my father fathered me, my father fathered us, my father fathered all that he covered transparently. And it's not a switch that he just hit one day. It is who he was from as far back as I know. When I talk to his frat brothers, when I talk to childhood friends or whatever, you know, this is who he was. So what that suggests to me is just be me. I called one of my close friends. He's got two children. We peers. Because I've been asking everybody, man, give me some pointers. give me some tips. And he said something to me that really just, it was so ingenious. I said, what pointers you got for me? He said, none. I said, okay, bro, come on now. What's up? He said, nah, just continue to be who you've been. He said, you've been pastoring youth, you've been a mentor, and you've been doing all these things. He said, the difference for you is going to be that people who you're dealing with, you may see them once a week, every so often, or, you know, whatever that schedule may be. He said, but for your children, you get a chance to daily and unrelentlessly download your doctrine into them. Ongoing. You know, he's got mantras with his children. They got decrees they say in the morning when they're getting up, and just all of these types of things, you know. And when you meet him, they just embody it, because he's sowing that, if you will. So I started doing something even before I got married. I started writing Tupac style. I don't know if some of y'all might know what I mean. Tupac was writing letters to his unborn children. You felt me? So, you know, you can get something from anybody. I said, well, if Tupac can do that, I can do that. Three pots. So I started writing letters and notes to my children. Hey, I didn't get it right today. You know, I'm trying to do some things and break some of my personal habits so y'all don't have to deal with this, etc. These are transparent letters. you know, just to go ahead and have that habit, that flow. Because I don't know what to expect. You know, my wife and I, we praying for 10 toes, 10 fingers, spinal cord in line, abdomen, everything tucked in where it's supposed to be. Y'all are parents, you don't. So, don't know what to expect. It could be young, dirty, something else. Got to be prepared for this. So, that's what I'm doing, is the habit of being myself and already having that dialogue and that conversation beforehand so that it's just a natural aggregation as we get to that point.
That's beautiful. Definitely doing things intentionally. And actually, that's what Apostle's been teaching about, doing things with intention, with purpose, with aggression, with faith. And that was spot on. That was really nice. Very, very nice. So, you know, as we close the interview today, I really don't want to leave, but I know we do. So before we do, I want to, Apostle Davis, if you can give us some final words before we close out the interview today.
Well, before we leave, I was very intentional, and I'm thankful that they accepted the invitation. The Roden family, who's in the audience, who would carry legacy. And I wanted them to experience you and what we're doing, because all around the world, families, young people who may have lost a husband or whomever seemingly prematurely can start to gather themselves and wrap their mind around the future lives in them. How much further Bishop Eddie L. Long goes is with you. It's with people like me who were true sons. How far Carton Roden goes, he's still alive in you. He won't die unless you quit. So we made a decision, we won't quit. You make a decision, you won't quit. He'll live on and he'll continue to impact lives. And that's what legacy is all about. Thank you so much. I don't know what I'm supposed to consecrate you as. It's one day, but whatever it is, my hands are going to be hot and ready, man.
All right. Thank you guys so much for the honor to allow me to be your moderator today. Apostle Davis, Lady Davis, thank you again. Wonderful opportunity with you, Ed.
I
enjoyed that.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, and a big shout out to the hosting church today, which is here, Refresh Family Church, Refresh Nation. Again, be sure to go out to edlongjr.com. That's edlongjr.com. Go out there and grab that book. You can also follow him on the social media platforms, Edward Long at Facebook. That's Edward Long on Facebook. Instagram at Ed Long Jr. TikTok at Ed Long Jr. I like this. It's consistent. And Twitter as well, Ed Long Jr. Certainly want you to go out there and follow him so you can continue to see the great things that he's doing here today. And if there's anything else I need to say here today, all right, very good. Again, we want to thank you so much for joining us here for this amazing, amazing interview with Ed Long Jr., the author of Son of a Bishop. After this interview here today, we'll be here for maybe about 30 minutes or so, and you can come and get your signed book, because this is also a book signing as well. So thank you so much for joining us. We'll see you tomorrow morning, 9 o'clock a.m. right here at Refresh Family Church, Refresh Nation. Have a good evening. Goodbye.
Testing, 1, 2. I wanted to share a few words once the stream had stopped, just for clarity's sake. So the order of the book.